M1220.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart. And our dreams, and they are made out of real things, like a shoebox of photographs with sepia tone loving.
Love. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Insight Teen Hour on KHTS AM 1220, 98.1 FM. My name is Eddie Garcia, counselor at Insight Treatment. And I'm here today with Sarah and Gabe, two teens who are going to talk about some of their mental health issues and their life story, history of struggling with those issues. So, hey, guys, how's it going?
Pretty good. How are you doing, Eddie?
I'm good. So how old are you, Sarah?
I am 18, almost 19.
All right, awesome. And I've known you for some time, right?
Yeah. We go way back.
Yeah, we've done this a few times too as well, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, cool. And what about you, Gabe? How's it going?
I'm doing all right today. How about you, Eddie?
I'm all right. How old are you?
Currently I'm 16 years of age.
You're 16. All right, cool. So let's jump right into it. So you guys struggled with some mental health issues growing up.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. Are you guys comfortable sharing maybe your diagnosis or what it was like, just a little bit real quick, so the listeners know what were the issues for you?
Yeah, for sure. I'll go first.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I suffer from depression, anxiety, and OCD, which was mostly taken care of by meds. So it's not a big part of my story, but those are the main things I dealt with ever since, like, middle school, probably.
Okay, since middle school. So what age would you say it started?
11 or 12.
Okay, yeah. Awesome. What about you, Gabe?
Well, when I was in around fourth or fifth grade, I was diagnosed with Tourette's, which brought in a lot of bullying. And, you know, that's been resolved with medications and whatnot. But all of that kind of...
Tourette's has been resolved.
The Tourette's has been resolved, yes, for like 90% of it. But, you know, growing up, I think I was around 10 or 11 when I first went to a psychiatrist, and I was diagnosed with depressive disorder and, you know, like... And just anxiety, I guess. And that was pretty much it. And, yeah, basically.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, for you, Sarah, started around 12. For you, you said
Fourth or fifth grade, yeah, after my parents' divorce.
So, I want to ask you both individually, whoever wants to go first. When you first realized maybe there was an issue or you were diagnosed and you were told there's an issue, what was your experience? How did you take that?
For me personally, I was glad to be diagnosed because I thought there was seriously something wrong with me. And I was like, dude, I'm like the only one that's like this. This kind of sucks, you know?
Yeah.
So when I was diagnosed in eighth grade with depression and anxiety, I was relieved that I knew that it wasn't something that I had to do, that I was alone in, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't get way better immediately after that, but
yeah,
that was a good relief.
So being diagnosed gave you a sense of relief.
Yeah.
Because it was like, oh, like, this is what's going on.
Yeah, and I knew that it was something can help me, you know.
Okay. Can you take me back a little bit before the diagnosis and your experience just struggling and not knowing what was going on?
Yeah, so I was very quiet about it. I didn't tell anyone about it because I thought whatever I was thinking in my head, like, whether it was suicidal thoughts or just anxious about everything, I thought it was bad and not, like, I wasn't supposed to be behaving that way, in quotes, you know, so...
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, so it was kind of... I kept it to myself, and I didn't want to tell anyone or anything like that. And so it just built up too much, and then it blew up.
So what you're saying is you were struggling,
mm-hmm.
and then it built up and got worse,
yes.
until you finally sought help.
Yes, I finally just kind of blew up in my mom's face, kind of.
Yeah,
like,
I remember that story.
Yeah,
we can talk a little bit about that later.
Yeah, I was just like, you know, I'm feeling this way, and then I slammed something on the table and ran to my room. So.
Yeah, okay, cool. What about you, Gabe?
Well, let's see. So kind of prior to getting diagnosed, what it was like, just kind of feeling that way.
Yeah, just experiencing what you experienced, what it was like for you.
Well, I mean, growing up in a household where my parents didn't really get along very well, there was a lot of arguing constantly, and, you know, I was financially and, you know, like, physically kind of supported. You know, I had a roof over my head. I had food on the table, but I wasn't really, you know, like emotionally kind of supported. And my dad was working a lot, and my mom was also working a lot. They were both kind of working. I remember spending like hours alone as like a 7, 8, 9-year-old kid.
So like feelings of loneliness, isolation.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. And I kind of thought that that was normal. I thought that like that was how life was supposed to be, you know? And I remember being at school. I was a very, you know, exuberant child. I tried to make everybody like me. I tried to fit in for people. And there was a very fine line that I didn't really know, which was like being entertaining and then just embarrassing myself, you know, like I didn't know what the difference was, because if I got people to laugh, you know, I was achieving my goal. So I kind of ended up just kind of making a fool out of myself most of the time. And this was in like, what, elementary school. And then in middle school, it just kind of got different, where I just kind of stopped being super loud and, you know, like fun all the time. And I started being a little bit more conceited.
So there's definitely a behavioral change. Yeah. Was there an emotional or mental change that with that?
Yeah, I feel like kind of like growing numb to certain things. Kind of like I remember when I was younger and my parents would argue, I would try to like get them to stop, you know, but then I learned that like my words didn't really matter to them that much. Like what I wanted didn't really mean anything. So yeah. I just kind of learned to just like keep my mouth closed.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a common theme in a lot of teenagers, is like when you're struggling and you don't know anything else, you can really feel like nothing's going to change. There's no point in trying to put in any effort because no one will understand me. I'm alone in this, which is something both of you are kind of talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm taking it from starting to really struggle. What kind of happened after that, once you realized there really is some issues going on, and at this point your parents were made aware that you guys were really struggling with something seriously? So can you guys go from there a little bit? Whoever.
Yeah, so after I told my parents what was happening and going on, she realized...
Do you want to tell that story?
Well, the story of, like, what the... well, like, I mean...
Whatever you want.
All right, so basically, I always... The main thing I struggled with was school. That's how it really showed that I was, like, struggling. Because I was doing really bad in school. I was a good student in elementary. But in middle school, I was doing so bad. And we would always argue about school and stuff. And then one time, I was, like, we were arguing about school. And I was, like, I just couldn't take it anymore. And I wanted to tell her, like, dude, I'm not feeling great, and that I'm sad all the time, and life doesn't look great, you know. But then I couldn't say that. I didn't know how to. So I grabbed, like, my diary that had, like, I don't know, like, 4 entries or something like that of, like, my lowest days ever. And I just slammed it on the table, and I was like, read that. That says everything. And then and I left my room. And so then she read it, which is really weird because most kids – You don't want your parents reading your diary. But
yeah.
For me, that's the only way I could, like, tell her what was going on. So, yeah, that's what happened. And then she came into my room. She's like, are you safe? Like, do you need to go somewhere right now? And I was like, no, I'm okay. I need help, you know. And so then she got me a therapist after that.
Yeah. So I like how I really like your story a lot whenever you share that whole journal thing, because for a lot of teens, you know, even a lot of people in general,
mm-hmm.
they're not very good at articulating your feelings, you know, and in therapy, they tell you, write it down, it can help, mm-hmm. and it really does.
Yeah, it definitely saved me, for sure.
Yeah, so if you can't even articulate it, how are you going to tell an adult, you know, what's really going on?
Exactly.
But in your case, you're like, here, just read it, everything's there.
Exactly, yeah.
So that's pretty cool, and it's very creative,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah, and I still do that to this day. I have, like, a document of just, like, rants. Just rant if I'm feeling, like really mad or any feeling, any strong feelings, I'll rant about it. And then I just leave it all there. I can read back it. Sometimes I'll just, like, laugh, like, oh, wow, that's kind of stupid.
Yeah, and then at the same time, you can take a look back at certain periods of time and see the change and the difference, right?
For sure. Like, I see where I am. I'm like, dude, that was a bad day. And I'm, like, at a way better spot right now.
Yeah.
And I'm, like, grateful. It makes me more grateful for the day.
Yeah, because you can look on those bad days and be like, wow, like, I was really thinking about some bad things about myself, about other people, about what's going on.
Exactly.
But, like, now it's like, oh, I got through it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of, like, when you do that, it's evidence that those really bad days aren't going to last forever. Cause
exactly. Yeah.
They feel like they can last forever.
Dude,
in that
it feels
moment.
Like it lasts for like out, like all day. It feels like you're doing it all. It's like all day you're just feeling terrible. But in reality, it's like an hour or two
yeah.
at the most.
Exactly.
You know? So, yeah.
Cool. All right. So what about you, Gabe? Once you really start to get professional help and your parents were made aware of the issues that was going on, what kind of what happened after that?
The first time I ever really got professional help, I was around 11 or 12,
that
I think.
That was after the Tourette's diagnosis
that
and
was,
the bullying.
That
and
was after that, yeah.
Okay.
And I was partaking in some unhealthy coping skills. And my mom found out about it. And
what were those?
Self-harm.
Self-harm,
yeah,
okay.
Just in the beginning.
So you're cutting with, like, a knife or other sharp objects, stuff
yeah,
like that?
Yeah, when I was in sixth grade. And my mom found out about that, and she sent me to a therapist. And it got a little bit better after that, but I was still left with the feelings that I was feeling before. Kind of like the – it kind of turned into, like, a lot of self-hatred and feeling like I wasn't worthy.
What did the therapist help with?
The therapist was just kind of there to mediate a family session about how they said, like, they're concerned for me.
Okay, so communicating. It helped you communicate.
Yeah.
It helped – did it give you – did you feel that you did have an outlet to, like, share about what was going on or
– Not really.
Not at that point?
Mm-hmm. Definitely not at that point. That didn't come until a lot later.
Okay.
But, yeah, I mean, after that kind of portion of, you know, self-harm then kind of came with – you know, substance experimentation, and that kind of replaced it.
So you were, what you're saying is you were struggling with the mental health issues.
Yes.
And then you found something that worked better.
I did find something that worked better, yes.
Okay, for you.
Mm-hmm, for me.
Go ahead.
And, so I was 11 at the time, and it got out of hand pretty quickly, and, you know, just kind of getting into trouble with, you know, school and you know, later on with the law enforcement and stuff like that. But it was all pretty difficult to kind of go through.
Okay, so what internally, what was going on for you? Can you go back and, like, think about what were you experiencing emotionally and internally that was causing you to self-harm? And then as you started to, you know, use drugs as a coping skill, what was going on and how did it affect all of that.
Yeah, well, I feel like a big part of it was just not feeling comfortable in my own skin. Just feeling like I'm not supposed to be here and, you know, not wanting to be here in a very general sense, not even talking about any specific location, just not wanting to be, like, you know, conscious. And I found that, you know, when I was under the influence of, you know, anything, I felt a lot more content and I felt a lot more peaceful. And, you know, the thoughts in my head that were previously there kind of stopped going so fast and it was all very slowed down. And I just felt happier. And that's kind of like how I wanted to feel all the time. So I made an effort to feel like that all the time.
Yeah, which, physiologically makes a lot of sense, you know. If you have some type of chemical imbalance, right?
Yeah.
Where your brain isn't producing, you know, the stuff to make that makes you feel good naturally,
mm-hmm.
you're going to try and find other ways to feel okay.
Yeah,
you
totally.
Know? Also, if you've experienced some type of trauma, it'll change the way your brain operates, so you're not really producing those same things. So it's real easy to find outside things, whether it's, you know, self-harm when you feel really bad, at least you feel something, you know?
Yeah,
or
exactly.
Using
kind of
drugs.
Switching the feelings, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Putting one feeling. That's a big part of self-harm for a lot of people. It's like, you feel internal pain, and it's a lot easier to focus on external pain. You know, it's a lot easier to switch your entire kind of focus on, you know, physical pain that you're feeling rather than having to deal with the, you know, torment on the inside that's going on.
Yeah, so since we're talking about self-harm, can you talk about, both of you talk about a little bit of the things that help when you're feeling like self-harming or other behaviors you can do instead so that aren't destructive? Because I don't want the listeners out there to just hear about, you know, the bad behavior without,
yeah.
like, this is what you can do instead.
Totally,
or,
yeah.
This is a different way you can deal with these issues, whatever that is. I want to hear from you guys your experience of what was helpful.
Yeah. For me, I mean, I still have urges to this day to self-harm, and I feel, like, really down. But it's like, dude, I just want to, you know. And usually what I do is I get out of my room. Because if I'm inside my bedroom, I feel, like, stuck in there and just stuck with all my feelings. So as soon as I walk into the living room, it's almost like I can breathe and, like, see more. You know, because inside my room, sometimes it's just, like, just all my feelings. It's just, like, I'm just, like, you know, drowning in it. And then when I open the door and I'm, like, I go to sit on the couch with my mom or, like, bug my brothers, then it's just, it helps me, like, distract myself. It's always about distracting myself from the urge.
Yeah.
So, I'll do that, or I'll call someone. And I won't necessarily call them to tell them what's going on. I'll just call them to be like, hey, what's up? How you doing? You know?
Yeah.
When I was first starting to, like, try to move away from self-harm, there were a lot of things that I did that was sort of, like, I would have something to fidget with. You know, I had to keep my hands busy. So whether it was, like, some actually, like, therapeutic toys or just a pen, you know?
Yeah.
It just, like, something to distract me from the feelings and the urges is what helped.
Just something. So, a saying that's said a lot is, hey, I'm in this spot right now, mm-hmm. right? And what you mean by that, it's a mental, emotional spot where you are in. It's not really something physical, but a lot of times, even doing something physical
mm-hmm.
or taking you out of that physical place can help, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Just getting out of the environment, you know?
Yeah.
That's what helped me the most.
Yeah, just some type of distraction, like, oh, you're thinking about this, focus on this, do this, whatever that is.
Yeah.
Exactly. What about with you, Gabe? What was helpful for you?
Well, I feel like there was definitely some positive coping skills that I partook in. There was definitely some negative coping skills that I partook in as well. But I feel like focusing on the positive ones is what you're asking for. So
the helpful stuff.
The helpful stuff that's beneficial to you and those around you. Definitely, I liked writing. I still do like writing. I haven't been writing as much. It started off in like second or third grade. I would like write comic books and stuff because I was bored and lonely in class. Or at lunch and stuff. And then it kind of just turned into, like, writing, like, short stories and stuff. I remember in seventh grade, I had this one teacher, and she had, like, a, what is it called? Like a writing contest, and, like the winner of the writing contest won a $10 Starbucks gift card. This was, like, throughout all of her periods and all her students, and I won for writing a story. And anyways, writing was something that I got into a lot, and kind of just, like, writing about, like, I would write, like, really dark stories to kind of just, like, throw my emotions into a fictional world that doesn't really exist to try to almost, like, vent it out.
Yeah.
And then I eventually turned to also just, like, poetry and stuff. I enjoy writing poetry. More specifically, poetry that doesn't really make sense when you first read it, because that's the kind of poetry that's the best, in my opinion. Animals help. My dog helps. Music.
Petting them.
Yeah, like, petting them, playing with them, just kind of holding them, you know, talking to them sometimes, too. Listening to music, you know, playing music. Like
I love music. Music's helpful for yes, sure.
Music's
for sure.
Very helpful, yeah.
You too, Sarah?
Oh, yeah. Music's always in my, every mm-hmm. day, you know, you can't go a day without listening to music.
Totally, yeah.
All right, so we got to take a commercial break. When we come back, we'll talk a little bit about more of the coping skills and, like, some of the writing and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get into some more of you guys' story.
Okay.
You're up, Gabe.
Thank you, Eddie. You're listening to KHTS AM 1220 FM 98.1 radio station.
And now a cooking tip from Keith Mowry from Bob's Country Meats. Everyone loves chicken. It's easy to cook in a variety of ways, especially on the barbecue.
Marinate it overnight in your favorite marinade. Brown it up nice on the barbecue. And then put it on the other side in direct heat. Close your lid. Take another 25, 30 minutes. And they're good.
Chicken, tri-tip, pork chops, turkey, steaks, even exotic game like buffalo and ostrich. For the tastiest chicken in town, visit Bob's Country Meats on Soledad in Canyon Country.
I'm Tamara Gurney, President and CEO of Mission Valley Bank. I'm here today to let you know that Mission Valley Bank has relocated our Centerpoint branch office. The new facility is 26701 McBean Parkway, directly across the street from the town center. We're very excited about this new, modern, and updated branch facility that we think is better situated to serve our growing number of small business clients. On behalf of myself and the entire Mission Valley Bank team, we're wishing you a very happy holiday season.
Mend Cryotherapy is open. As always, they continue to clean and sanitize all equipment. Social distancing will be enforced and hand sanitizer will be provided throughout the facility. Temperature checks will be done daily on each employee, and masks will be provided if forgotten. They have amazing welcome back specials, including the $99 performance package, which includes a cryo session, pulsed electromagnetic field therapy, which boosts recovery of damaged cells, the aromatherapy oxygen bar, NuCom, and infrared sauna. There's also a beauty package with a cryofacial, infrared sauna, and more. And don't forget their extensive selection of health and wellness products, including CBD. Men Cryotherapy is open Monday through Saturday, 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. For more information, go to mendcryotherapy.com. Mend Cryotherapy on Newhall Ranch Road in the Gateway Shopping Center.
There is only one language spoken at Thai Dish, and it sounds something like this.
This is great.
Once people get a taste of Thai dishes, there's really no reason to do any more talking. Make it full of flavor, make it delicious, only at Thai Dishes. Enjoy the atmosphere, love the food. Thai Dishes on Valencia Boulevard for free delivery, 253-FOOD. That's 253-F-O-O-D.
Oh,
I listen to it all day, every day.
Hometown, your hometown station.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try.
All right, welcome back to the Insight Teen Hour here at KHTS. As we were here with Sarah and Gabe talking about some of the mental health issues, we're going to jump right back into some of the coping skills we were talking about and a little bit of a different coping skills. So obviously we were talking about some of the stuff that's helpful and some of the things that when you're really struggling can take you out of that spot where we talk about that physical, emotional place where you feel and think certain things. But what I also want to ask you guys is, what are some of the bad coping skills, which usually, you know, a lot of times it's behaviors like lying, manipulating. The reason why we call them bad coping skills is because you pick up these behaviors, you pick up these habits to continue doing things you're not supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
So you have to kind of be a little bit secretive. And then obviously acting in that way can affect you. So however you guys want to take it from there, talk about that. Let's get into that.
Well, for me, my main thing was I would never tell my mom honestly how I felt. Most of the time it was because I didn't want to burden her. And a lot, and so I would just not say, like, she'd be like, how was your day? I'd be like, oh, it was good. You know, I'm fine. You know, and it made me, like, not feel like I was heard, but it was my own fault because I wasn't sharing, you know, what was really going on. So then I went into this thing where I was like, I didn't tell her how I was actually feeling. So then I would,
So you're being dishonest.
Yeah, I was being dishonest. If I'm not telling her how I'm actually feeling, how am I supposed to get any help? You know, it was kind of like self-destructing.
Yeah. So you're being dishonest and then you feel disconnected because you're not letting people know where you're at.
Exactly. Then I would like almost blame my mom, like, oh, she's not helping me. But it's like, it's me, you know, I have to take the first step and be honest and be like, hey, I'm not doing well right now. I'm actually really sad. I feel like doing something stupid even, you know. But I wouldn't tell her, and it would just eat me up sometimes because I'd be like, you know, like in my bed at night, I'll be like, I should have told my mom what was happening because now here I am stuck with all these thoughts. And if I had told her, she might have been able to help me more, you know.
Yeah.
So that was a thing that I did that didn't help me, you know. Yeah, that's pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you make a good point where, you know, when you're really struggling mentally, emotionally, with mental health issues, with all of that, you lack connection.
Yes, yeah.
Because you feel different.
Yeah.
You feel alone.
Yeah, and then it doesn't help if I'm not reaching out, you know?
Yeah.
If I'm stuck in this alone feeling and I don't tell anyone about it, I'm just going to stay stuck, you know?
Exactly.
So.
And it can be really hard to change your behavior so you do something different and exactly, you get out of this spot, right?
Yeah, exactly, because you're comfortable in that spot. It's not a good spot, but you're comfortable in it because that's all you really know. And so it's hard to, like, push yourself out of there, out of your comfort zone, and, like, say what's really going on, you know?
Yeah, and I think for a lot of humans in general, it's a lot easier to be comfortably uncomfortable
exactly.
than to do something that's uncomfortable and different
yeah.
out of the norm, out of our habits. And that's where really the change happens. And,
yes.
you know, you really start to see the building of connection and friendships and being real with other people, mm-hmm. which isn't easy. Like, no. It's not
easy at all, no. I'm always worried about, like, you know, am I saying too much or am I saying too little? You know, it's always, like, you know, I'm always wondering, like, do they even care what's going on with me right now?
Yeah.
You know?
And that's a process too, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like, when you go from doing nothing to change to trying to do everything to change and mm-hmm. be realizing, like, oh, maybe I'm, like, trying too hard, I'm doing too much, I'm talking too much.
Yeah, yeah. And people, like, I'm like, are they noticing that I'm, like, making an effort to, like, you know, be a little different, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And that's okay, too. And then people can give you some feedback, and then you, like, tone it down a little
bit. Exactly, yeah.
And you figure out what's appropriate and what works for you.
Yeah, if the people, if you're surrounding yourself with people that care about you, you don't have to worry about that, you know? You don't have to worry about wanting to change and them not accepting that, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Which is what we talk a lot about at Insight, you know?
Yeah.
I'm creating that community of people who do that.
Exactly,
you know?
Yeah.
Creating this community where people, you have the people to connect to be authentic with, who will hold you accountable. Like, hey, you're not trying. Like, you were doing really good last week, and, like, this week, you're,
yeah.
like, messing up. Like,
exactly.
what's going on?
Yeah, they're always right there. Like, hey, you're slacking a bit there, you know?
So, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Thank you, Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
So, Gabe, a little bit about, like, you know, the bad behaviors, the bad coping skills that, you know, allowed for you to continue doing what you were doing.
For sure. Well, I feel like at least in my opinion, you know, in my humble subjective view, a bad coping skill or a bad kind of, like, behavior is, you know, like one of the three. It, you know, it negatively affects you negatively or negatively affects, like, other people or both, you know. I feel like if it falls into any one of those categories, it can be considered, like, a negative coping
skill.
Wow,
that's really good. That's a really good way
to
put it.
So if you're doing something that you don't know is, like, is this bad for me? Is this, you know, is this okay to do? You just got to look at it. Take a look at it.
Yeah.
And a lot of the things that I was doing, I justified. I remember one of the, I don't know if it was a coping skill or just a dumb thing that I like to do is, you know, my mom remarried when I was around 11 or 12. And this guy, Richard, he wasn't really the nicest person, you know, given, you know, now I'm able to take accountability for certain parts of our relationship. But he didn't treat me well. I didn't treat him well. And I ended up stealing a lot of money from him. And I justified that kind of, like, you know, theft by saying, you know, like, oh, he's treating me poorly. You know, like, he deserves this. Or, like, I deserve to keep this, you know? Like, there's nothing wrong with this because, you know, he, you know, called me so-and-so, and he, you know, took off my door and, you know, like, took all my clothes and put them in his closet.
Yeah. So he's treating me this way, so I can do this.
Exactly. Yeah, no, exactly. And, you know, it might have been, you know, quote-unquote positively benefiting me because, you know, I had money in my pocket and stuff. But, you know, if I really took a step back and looked at it, like, the way I'm able to look at it now, it, you know, it definitely wasn't good, and, you know, it almost got me to a lot of legal trouble because when he found out, he tried pressing charges on me, and my mom kind of convinced him not to.
Yeah.
That
so,
was tough.
Other than justifying it mm-hmm. with how he treated you, what kept you from looking at it, like, objectively and saying, like, this is something bad that I shouldn't be doing? Was that, other than the justification, was there anything else?
I was under the influence, and I couldn't really think correctly.
Yeah.
I wasn't making the right decision. You know, I wasn't able to
so
look
you were
at things.
Skewed.
I was skewed. My point of view was very altered, and I stopped caring
yeah.
at a certain point. You know, I stopped caring about how other people felt towards the things that I did.
Yeah, I think that's key. Like, when you stop caring about how it affects other people.
Yeah.
Because it's benefiting you.
I was only thinking about myself.
Yeah. So, like, looking back at it, you know, your thought process can be very selfish. And in that moment, it doesn't feel that way, right? It feels more like, this is what I need, this is what I want, and I'm not going to think about other people. I'm not going to think about how it hurts them, how it affects them.
Exactly.
What they're going to think about me. It doesn't matter, because I want to do this. I want to feel better. I want to hang out with my friends I shouldn't be hanging out with. I want to use these drugs, whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, you get in a very narrow mindset. So what kind of helped change that, where you can look at it now the way you do?
I got sent to multiple treatment facilities.
Can you do a quick little rundown of what the different types of places you've been to?
February 2019, I had just ended about a 6-month bender of using inhalants, and the last kind of straw for my parents was I was found behind some buildings passed out, and I ended up waking up in handcuffs. And the next couple of days I got sent to a residential treatment facility, which is basically like a rehab where you go live there. And I spent about 28 days there. And then I went to outpatient program, which is like almost like school, but for like, you know, kids with, I don't know, mental health issues and drug addiction, stuff like that. I spent about 7 weeks there. I ended up getting kicked out because I was very aggressive towards people because I was still using consistently. And then I got sent to a wilderness program, which if you don't know, it's like a really long backpacking trip with
camping out
it's
in the
it's
wild.
Like camping, but you have a really heavy backpack and you're walking like up to like 8 miles a day. And I stayed out there for about 93 days, so like about 3 months. And I mean, in the end, I look back on it now and I really appreciated that experience. It was very nice. I met a lot of
nature or
out in nature. Yeah, up in Washington, the Olympic Peninsula. It was a very, very, very beautiful area.
Yeah.
I
think being out in nature and connecting with, like, you know, the ocean, the forest, the snow, it can also be very helpful to a lot of people.
It can, yeah. It kind of makes you look at the big picture of life and things, you know, like physical possessions don't matter. You know, I was carrying around my entire life in a backpack for 3 months.
Yeah.
You know, like everything I needed, my food, my clothes, my tent, my sleeping bag.
You kind of learn to be self-sufficient.
Self-sufficient,
with, like, the environment.
Yeah.
Like, find some berries. Okay, totally. Those are poisonous. We can't eat those.
Yeah,
you know,
no.
You can't eat those mushrooms, whatever.
I remember I liked to forage about halfway through my stay. One of the guides named Daniel, he taught me different leaves and, like, plants.
Like
in the
edible ones and non-edible?
Non-edible ones, ones that you can make tea out of.
Oh, okay. That's
yeah,
cool.
And I ended up making my own kind of concoction of tea. And, you know, who knows? It was pretty good. It tastes very planty, but I used licorice root to make it sweet, which is something I didn't know you could do. But and then I got out, and on the last day I ended up stealing again. I stole a whole bunch of food because we were severely underfed. But anyways, that kind of, like, they consider that as like relapse behavior. So then I got sent to this place called Evolve, which was another residential inpatient rehab. So I stayed there. I lived there for about 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then I got transferred over to this place called Ascend, which is another residential rehab facility. And I stayed there for about 49 days or so, near like 2.5 months. And then I got out, and a couple weeks later, I went to Insight. And I've been in Insight since October of 2019 or so. I've been here for like over a year.
Okay.
You know? It's been a rocky road. You know, I've had my struggles. I've had my ups and my downs, mostly downs, but
mostly downs.
Mostly downs.
But you're doing good right now, right?
I'm doing okay, relatively okay. I have maybe 5 months sober. You know.
Awesome. That's great. That's
really
good.
Appreciate it. So.
And you have like really good friends right now that like care about you, want you to be sober, want you to be doing good.
I do. Yes, the first time in my life, I had people in my life that really cared about the decisions I made. I remember.
Like,
having,
your inner circle actually cares.
My inner circle actually cares. I remember I used to be in school, and I used to partake in distributing various things to people. And I did that.
You're doing some bad stuff.
I was doing bad stuff. And a large portion of why I did that was because I wanted to feel wanted. Like, I wanted people to, like, see me as somebody who, like, they need, you know? I wanted to, yeah. like, have friends. I wanted to, like, have people to talk to. It wasn't even about, you know, making money or, like, you know, that kind of stuff. It was just about I wanted to be recognized by people. You know, I wanted to have
you
friends.
Wanted validation.
I wanted validation.
Friendship.
I wanted people to like me.
You wanted connection.
I wanted connection, exactly. Absolutely. And for, like, the first time in my life, for, like, you know, 16, 15 years, I have people that actually care about me. Because the people back then, like, they would see me doing some stupid stuff, and they would be like, hey, you should not do that as often. You know, like, maybe, like, a couple times a week is okay, but not every single day. Just, like, chill out.
Like, hey, you're doing that bad thing, and it's okay for you to do it, but you're doing it too much.
Exactly. No, exactly. That's exactly how it was, most definitely.
Yeah.
I had one friend that cared about me, and after a while of kind of acting like that, he was like, no, Gabe, you need to stop this, like, fully. And I was like, nah, dude, I'm not going to do that. And he's like, I can't stop you. I'm just telling you that it's not going to end up well for you. And he was right.
Yeah, and I feel like you have friends now that, you know, they might tell your mom or they might tell the counselor, like,
yeah, no, exactly.
Stuff. Yeah.
No, yeah, definitely. It's the first time in a while.
Yeah. Sarah, could you give us a quick little history of what kind of
treatment?
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been into, like, I've been to the mental hospital 5 times, in and out within the span of 1 year. And I stayed there for an average of, like, 10 days, you know, for suicide attempts and self-harm. And then in 2018, I went to a residential because they wanted to send me to the hospital, but I wasn't a harm to myself. So they had to send me to a residential instead.
And that's a common issue that you've heard about, right?
Yeah. Like, yeah. So actually, they didn't know what to do at first. They're like, well, she's not harming herself, so we don't know what to do, you know. They're like, well, we can send her to finally someone was like, we'll send her to a residential. And so I went to there for like a month and a half, and that was a great experience. I actually got a lot of help there and support. Yeah. And then I went to Insight after the residential.
Okay, can you talk about a little bit about just going through the treatment, you know, what you can look back on that you enjoyed or helped? I mean, not enjoy, I guess, because it's not an enjoyable thing.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
The part that helped the most was the staff. Some of the treatment centers had terrible staff, and they were just, like, didn't care about you. They just wanted to do their job. Some places, the staff just, like, connected with you. They were like, hey, I understand what you're going through, you know. They were so supportive.
Absolutely. It makes a huge
difference.
And,
you know, being with people that are struggling with that, too, like other kids or teens, it also helped a lot too. And just being able to like focus on just my health was really helpful.
Yeah. So putting yourself first and really building that connection with others. So I want to go back a little bit about the nature part, cause that's something like we do at Insight, you know, we go on these trips that are really cool and really fun. Mm-hmm. I can't remember exactly, but Sarah, did you not want to go on a few of them at first?
The first one I was hesitant to go on.
Because you were, like, scared?
And yeah, I was new to the program. I didn't want to go, and I didn't want to participate in any of the activities.
Where did we go that day?
That was Big Bear.
That was Big Bear, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then impulsively, I just decided to jump in the lake, which was, like, a big step because Sarah was quiet. She didn't do much, you know, and all of a sudden she's just, you know, jumping into the lake, and I was like, oh, wow, all right, you know, and I just felt free.
Yeah.
And the cold water gave me like this rush. I was like, I felt like alive, you know.
Yeah.
It was really, really cool.
You're feeling alive. I think that's a good way to put it. Like, why I personally value a lot the outdoors.
Yes.
Like, I connect it with spirituality and connecting to like the universe, but we don't need to get into that. Anyways, why I'm bringing it up is when you're really struggling and you're in these quote unquote spots. You know, you don't want to go outside. You don't want to go on a hike. You don't want to go on a boat. You don't want to play in the snow. You
want to bury yourself inside your covers and just sleep.
Yeah. And, you know, if you've been in this spot for a while, you end up, like, painting your room black. Mm-hmm. And your room starts to match what's going on with you internally.
Yeah.
You know, that's something we really see. So I really do see the value in, like, you know, going out there. Mm-hmm. And then even if you don't want to, you know, if we pressure you a little bit, you know, we convince you, we get you to go, you end up jumping in the lake and you feel alive.
Exactly.
When you know, we're struggling to, like, feel, we are struggling with feelings of not feeling good about yourself. and then you feel alive. So it's like, oh, wait.
Yeah, it was definitely a boost for sure in confidence and just overall my mood, you know?
Yeah. Which, you know, I really appreciate that we do that because, like I said, you know, the outdoors are, like, amazing.
Yes.
You know? So we're about to go on a commercial break. When we get back, we're going to talk a little bit about more the benefits of sharing our stories and why we find it so important to do things like this and have Gabe and Sarah share, you know, how they struggled and how it was for them. You can tune in on KHTS, AM 1220, and 98.1 FM.
Santa Clarita Valley residents now have greater access to the excellent physicians and high-quality medical services for which Providence Holy Cross is known. Providence Holy Cross Health Center in Santa Clarita features state-of-the-art cancer and imaging technologies, as well as board-certified physicians in a variety of medical specialties. Quality and compassion from a healthcare provider you can depend on. For more information, call 1-888-HEALING or visit us at providence.org.
There is only one language spoken at Thai Dish, and it sounds something like this.
This is great.
Once people get a taste of Thai dishes, there's really no reason to do any more talking. Make it full of flavor, make it delicious, only at Thai Dishes. Enjoy the atmosphere, love the food. Thai Dishes on Valencia Boulevard for free delivery, 253-FOOD. That's 253-F-O-O-D.
Oh.
98.1 FM and AM 1220.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart. And our dreams, and they are made out of real things, like a shoebox of photographs with sepia tone loving.
All right, we're love back here at the Insight Teen Hour. I'm Eddie Garcia with Gabe and Sarah. We've been talking about their mental health struggles, how they've found connection and how community has helped them, how the outdoors, you know, can be very beneficial. I want to kind of get into why we do this and how beneficial it is, because I'll tell a quick little story. I remember your first time we did it, Sarah. You remember?
Oh, yeah.
You didn't want to do it.
Not at all.
You're like, I don't want to do it. Why should I do this?
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then we convince you to do it. Mm-hmm. And can you talk a little bit about your experience going out to a school and sharing your story? Because typically we do go out to, like, the high schools and have our teens share their stories to really help reduce the stigma around mental health. And, why was it? What did you gain from it? What was your experience with that?
It was really eye-opening. I felt, like, powerful. I felt like I can actually make a difference, you know? It's hard to explain almost because, like, I was so nervous. And I was like, I don't want to talk to people about my business. Like, that's just weird, you know?
Yeah.
And then I go and I talk to these kids. I think they were middle schoolers. I think they were middle schoolers. And so I'm, like, looking at all these young faces that were younger than me, and I was like, I'm sharing this story, and they're like, they're listening. And then I felt like, dude, this is helpful. You know, if someone had come to me and started sharing all this relatable stuff that I was sharing, it would have been very helpful. So after my first time, I kept wanting to do it.
Yeah, and then when we did it, I think we just jumped right into it. You did, like, 3 in 1 day.
Oh, yeah. I did. One. I talked, like, for, like I think it was half an hour, like three times.
Yeah.
And so that's, like, the most I've ever talked about myself for, like, a straight period of time, you know?
Yeah.
Besides in therapy, but even then.
Yeah, so there's a few different pieces of it, you know? Like, it helps you.
Yeah.
Because you see that you can be helpful to others.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
And then a lot of times, you know, you talk about in therapy, but you kind of have, like, this goal, or you tend to, like, go in a certain direction with the dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
But just sitting there and telling your story, you can look back and be like, oh, wow, like, I've come a long way.
Yeah, after that time, I was like, dude, it's been a long journey, but, like, I've come out on the other side, you know? It's like you could just see your whole life and just see, like, how much you've come, how far you've come. Yeah. And it was eye-opening, and that's why I keep doing it. You know, I like to help people out.
Yeah.
And after I'm helping me at the same time. Yeah.
After that time, you're like, let's do it. Let's go. Yeah, when do we have another one? Let's
Eddie, when's the next one? Hurry up. You know?
It's been a while, but here we are in the radio.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
for sure.
Awesome.
Yeah.
What about you, Gabe? You just recently started doing the panels. I remember I went with some other people, and you're like, hey, I want to do it. And it's been a while since that happened. And then, you know, COVID, we didn't have any.
Yeah, really, exactly.
But recently, I asked you, and you're like, yeah, I still want to do it. Let's go.
Mm-hmm.
So what has been your experience?
Well, let's see. I feel like it's very different, you know, talking in front of, like, a large group of people, kind of like what you did and what other people have done.
Yeah, 'cause we've been doing them on Zoom.
Yeah, that's what the panels that I've been doing on Zoom. So it's a little different than just, like, talking into a computer than, like, actually looking at, like, faces and speaking. But I feel like definitely, like you said, it can be helpful to people. It can for sure just, like, either just, like, maybe something that you say, like, somebody hears, and something that you say resonates with somebody. That's just what my hope is, that anything that I can say can actually resonate with anybody that's listening.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like, the point of, like, I don't know, like, a panel or something is to just, you know, just share your story and share your experience with struggles that you're having, or not even struggles. Maybe if you're talking about, like, fitness or whatever you want to talk about, just being able to share something from your point of view and seeing if other people can relate to you or agree with you on stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I feel a lot of times people aren't used to hearing someone be so real and so authentic with, like, really, you know, hard things that have happened to them, really, like, sensitive things. And by doing that, creates this connection to those people, whether they're strangers or not. And even right now on Zoom, a lot of people in the chat will tell us, hey, you know, thank you so much for coming out here. We value your stories, you know. But I remember there's been multiple times where we go in person.
Oh, yeah.
And they come up to us afterwards, you
know. Yeah, they give you hugs. They'll pass you a secret note and be like, thank you for your share.
Please call me.
Yeah, exactly. You know, like, follow me on Instagram, you know. But, yeah.
That's their love.
The main thing I always say is that if I've touched at least one person in the group of whatever 30, 40 people, I feel like I've accomplished something. That's all I needed.
Yeah.
You know, it just takes one, and I feel like, okay, I've helped this person, you know?
Yeah. So. Yeah, I mean, the feedback we get is amazing. The panels are my favorite thing. You know, being in recovery myself, like, obviously part of that is sharing your story with other people to try and help them and being of service to them in that way. But the feedback we get, like, it really touches my heart, and I'm very passionate about what we do because, you know, when a kid comes up to you and tells you, hey, I've never been able to put it into words, but you said exactly what I feel, and you're telling me your experience, but I have the same experience, and I've never been able to articulate it that well.
Yeah.
And they're, like, about to bawl. It's, like, very powerful.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So at Insight, you know, we really take a lot of pride in trying to help the community in any way we can, and that is one of, like, that's my favorite thing, like I always say. Because, you know, we have the resources to do it. And, like, your guys' stories are so powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And being able to share it is such a great tool for, you know, anyone in the crowd. Mm-hmm. Whether it's them struggling, whether it's a brother, an uncle, a parent. You know, because what I always say is, whether you struggle with these issues or you don't know anyone who has struggled with these issues, maybe down the line you'll have someone in your life who you can help because of this.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe down the line you'll need this information for yourself. And you know, I really feel everyone should, you know, really start to, like, open their ears to these issues, because, you know, we're all affected by it.
Exactly.
So that about ends it for our show.
Yeah.
Thank you guys so much for coming out.
Yeah,
today, I think this was super special.
Thank you very much, Eddie.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, so thank you guys. Tune in to KHTS AM 1220 FM 98.1. This is the Insight Teen Hour. Thank you.
Thank you.